The Canaanite people predate the arrival of Israelites by roughly 2 millennia. The Proto-Canaanites arose around 3500 BC as a Mesopotamian-based country and settled in sites such as Ebla, from which we derive the Ebla archive, and other places west of the Euphrates. Canaan is a region in the ancient Near East during the late 2nd millennium BC, situated in the southern Levant. The setting comprises regions of Phoenicia, Philistia, and parts which would later be known as Israel. Canaan had significant geopolitical importance in the late Bronze Age Amarna period, as the area where the spheres of interest of the Egyptian, Hittite, and Assyrian empires converged. Knowledge of Canaan from archaeological sources is almost exclusively from artifacts dated to the period in which the region existed under the hegemony of the New Kingdom of Egypt. Since the Egyptian Empire controlled this region during that time, much of our knowledge from archaeology comes from the Amarna letters and other documents of governance which record information from the time of Egyptian rule. Much of the primary source knowledge of Canaan stems from excavations in areas such as Tel Hazor, Tel Megiddo, and Gezer. The late Bronze Age state of Ugarit, what is now Ras Shamra in Syria, is considered a quintessential source of Canaanite culture and religion, from which was found the Ugaritic texts and other artifacts of Canaanite culture. The Israelite religion is one which originated out of these Bronze Age polytheistic ancient Semitic religious traditions, specifically the Canaanite religion. It exhibits a syncretization with elements from Babylonian religion as well as some Egyptian influences. The religion began as a henotheistic offshoot of the Canaanite worship of El, along with his secondary epithet, Yahweh, which refers to El Yahweh Sabaoth, often translated as Lord of Hosts, which likely means El who creates the armies. El, who was the supreme god of the Mesopotamian Semites, later became the chief god of the Hebrew Bible. In Canaan, he was known to be the father and the ruler of the divines, as well as the creator. The god of the Jews evolved gradually from the Canaanite El, who was the high god of the pantheon, to the Israelite El, who is likewise the chief god of the Hebrews. The essential qualities of the Canaanite El were retained in the god of the Hebrews, along with memories of the theogony of El and the gods. Over time, the Israelite group of Canaanites converged the sky gods El and his son Baal-Hadad, and El was conflated as Yahweh. Early on, the Israelites also worshipped Yahweh along with his wife Asherah, who was originally the consort of El in the Canaanite tradition. For a long time, scholars of the Hebrew Bible concluded that a major difference between the God of the Bible and the gods of other traditions was that so-called pagan gods had sexual lives and consorts, while Yahweh did not. But in the late 20th century, archaeologists uncovered two intriguing inscriptions from two Middle Eastern sites. The inscriptions were blessings not only in the name of Yahweh, but also his consort, Asherah. Over time, there was a push towards monolatry, the worship of one god among many, but not necessarily denying the existence of other gods, which made it so that the Israelites' focus on El Yahweh compelled them to make it appear that there was a greater divide between Yahweh and the older god, Baal. Thus, in order to build up and emphasize the distinction between Yahweh and Baal, the Hebrew text goes to great lengths to make Yahweh's conflict with Baal apparent. This marked the trend of Israel rejecting its heritage. Although the Israelites apparently broke off from Canaanite tradition at some point, the essential elements from the Canaanite sources were maintained in the Bible, such as the same dwellings and epithets of El. El resides on Mount Zaphon, and in certain texts he dwells within a tent, just like the tabernacle described in Exodus. Titles of the Canaanite El were preserved in the Hebrew tradition, such as the following: Elyon, which is Most High; Rechem, which is Bull. Also, El was called the God of Patriarchs, a warrior, and El was called Olam, which means Eternal. These were the names for the Canaanite El, and they became the names for the Hebrew El. Interestingly, Babel, relating to Babylon, is a conjunction of Bab and El, meaning Gate of the God. But it was not singly El from which Yahweh evolved, but also Baal-Hadad. the Canaanite storm god. Indeed, also the name which Jews substitute for Yahweh, lest they utter it, is Adonai, the term from Canaanite Adon, which means Lord. It's a synonym for Baal, which also means Lord. The connection between Yahweh and Baal is undeniable. We find narrative instances of the Israelites' understanding of this connection in parts of the Hebrew text, such as Exodus 32:8, the crafting of the bull by Aaron and the Hebrews as Moses was on Sinai, in which it is said, "These are your gods, O Israel." We see in the Israelite religion precisely what one should expect to see from a religion evolving from and assimilating religions surrounding it. In numerous passages, Yahweh is depicted as any ancient Near East storm deity, the most notable of which is Baal Hadad. Like Baal, Yahweh is a warrior who descends from his mountain home, riding on a chariot of clouds. His voice is thunder, and his weapon is lightning. The earth quakes, and the skies release rain at his command. In primeval times, he asserted his authority by defeating the sea, becoming the ruler of the skies. Exodus 15:3 reads, "Yahweh is a warrior. Yahweh is his name." Numbers 23:22, "El, who brings them out of Egypt, is for them the horns of a wild bull." Numbers 24:8, "El, who brings him out of Egypt, is like the horns of a wild bull for him. He shall devour the nations that are his foes and break their bones." El of the Canaanites was also called bull and warrior. Here are some examples of parallels between Baal and Yahweh as attested to by the Ugaritic literature in the Baal cycle and the Hebrew Bible. "Let me tell you, Prince Baal. Let me repeat, Rider on the Clouds. Now your enemy, Baal, now you will kill your enemy. Now you will annihilate your foe. You will take your eternal kingship, your dominion, forever and ever." And the Hebrew Bible reads, "Behold your enemies, Yahweh. Behold your enemies perish. All evildoers are scattered. Your kingship is an eternal kingship. Your dominion is forever and ever." The parallels with Baal extend also to the motif of the mountain where Yahweh revealed himself. "There was thunder and lightning and a heavy cloud on the mountain. And Mount Sinai was covered with smoke because Yahweh had descended upon it in fire, and the whole mountain trembled violently." The same imagery is used of Baal's theophany. "Then Baal opened a break in the clouds. Baal sounded his holy voice. Baal thundered from his lips. The earth's high places shook." The association of Yahweh as a storm god is also echoed in Judges chapter 5, verses 4 through 5. "Yahweh, when you went out from Seir, when you marched from the highland of Edom, the earth shook, and the heavens too streamed, and the clouds streamed with water. The mountains shook before Yahweh, the one of Sinai, before Yahweh, the God of Israel." And Psalm 104, verse 3, "Yahweh sets the beams of his chambers on the waters. He makes the clouds his chariot. He rides on the wings of the wind." There is also a shared emphasis on the seventh day, for it was on the seventh day of Daniel's incubation rite in the temple that Baal intercedes for him and El blesses him, just as it is on the seventh day that Yahweh called to Moses on the cloud-covered mountain. Indeed, the characteristic origin of Yahweh in the roots of El and Baal is preserved in Hosea 2:16, which reads, "Yahweh says, you will call me my husband, and no longer my Baal." Frank M. Cross suggested in 1973 a potential connection with the Egyptian deity Ptah, who was given the title Dugiti, Lord of Gath, in which Ptah is called Lord Eternal, and that it may be this identification of El with Ptah that led to the epithet Olam, which means eternal, so early and so consistently with the Israelites. Another similarity is that both the gods Ptah and El create the world through their very will, and not through a divine battle between gods. The Jews also seem to be oddly concerned with circumcision, which serves as another connection to Egyptian culture. The earliest historical record of circumcision comes from Egypt in an inscription of the tomb at Saqqara dating to around 2400 BC. While circumcision might have been done for hygienic reasons, it was for the Egyptians part of their obsession with purity and was associated with spiritual and intellectual development. These connections would all make sense considering the Levant was politically and culturally dominated by the Egyptian Empire in the time the Israelites are thought to have arisen by the end of the Late Bronze Period. However, it is probably not until Iron Age I that a population began to identify itself as Israelite, and the Israelite, or the earliest documented instance of the name Israel, is from the Egyptian stele of Merneptah, around 1208 BC, in which it records that Israel is laid waste, and his seed is not. The earliest possible occurrence of the name Yahweh is as a place name in the Egyptian inscription from the time of Amenhotep III, who reigned from 1402 to 1363 BC. It refers to the land of Yahu, which is the land of the Shashu, being nomads from Midian. Thus, the worship of Yahweh seems to have originated in areas south of Israel. The name Yahweh, which can take on various forms in the Semitic tongue of Yah for theophoric purposes, for example, Adonijah, which is Adon, master, and Yahu, referring to Yah or Yahweh, contains the core name Yah. Along with being the chief and ruler god, Yahweh shares unequivocal resemblances to the Sumerian god Yah, who is culturally synonymous with Marduk and Baal-Hadad. Yah and Yah, or Yahweh, are virtually the same god. The Torah draws heavily from other ancient Near East influences which pre-existed it, incorporating and modifying them. Things such as the laws of Eshnunna, Hammurabi, Middle Assyrian laws, and Ur-Nammu. The covenant theme, which runs throughout, is known to be directly related to the Hittite suzerainty contracts and the vassal treaties of Esarhaddon. One example of the covenant theme from outside the Hebrew Bible lies in the Phoenician-inscribed Arslan Tash amulets, which refer to the Eternal One's Covenant, a Council of Holy Ones, and the Sons of El. Interestingly, there's also a 5th century AD Christian amulet from Cyprus which associates Re and Osiris with Yahweh and Jesus, in imagery on one side, and a palindrome text on the other, stating, Yahweh is the bearer of the secret name, the Lion of Re secure in his shrine. This is interesting because the throne of El is depicted with features of a lion, and the earliest possible instance of El and an artifact depicting him with two lions. The Israelite accounts of creation contain clear allusions to ancient Near Eastern cosmogonies. The first verses draw upon the Babylonian epic Enuma Elish, which means when on high. Both begin with a temporal clause, the book of Genesis beginning with when El created the sky and earth, in which also nothing existed but primeval waters, male and female, fresh and salt, Apsu and Tiamat, respectively. The god Marduk manages to create the world by destroying Tiamat with wind, ripping her asunder and forming the sky and the earth from her carcass. Genesis applies the same styles and motifs of its ancient Near Eastern setting, only demythologized, that lacks any theogony of the gods which the texts discuss. The memory of the battle narrative, though, is preserved in other parts of the Tanakh. There are still significant differences, however, between typical ancient Near East religious traditions and the Hebrew Bible, the most remarkable feature being the suppression of mythology in the Hebrew tradition. There is no biography or theogony of Yahweh. While the Bible is not mythology, it does indeed contain myths and legends. The polemical inversion of the Hebrew narrative, as opposed to other myths, is apparent in the emphasis on human importance and dignity created in divine image, which is lacking in the narratives of their ancient Near East neighbors, where humans tend to be menials. Human affairs are the theme of importance in the biblical account, and thus the absence of mythologized stories of gods is substituted with mythologized stories of humans. In that sense, the often suggested question, is the Bible trustworthy in depicting historical events, is a wrong question, to which the answer would be no. A better question would be, is the Bible trustworthy in depicting historical opinions? And the answer to that is an obvious yes. The text of the Torah is constituted of at least five sources as described in Wellhausen's theory: J. Yahwist, written around 950 BC in Judah; E. Elohist, written around 850 BC in Israel; D. Deuteronomist, written around 600 BC in Jerusalem; P. Priestly, written around 535 in exile of Babylon; and R. Redactor, which is the final edition of the combined sources. Although Wellhausen's dates have been disputed, and any of the sources could be decades, if not centuries, later. In fact, the Hebrew Bible itself explicitly admits this sort of phenomena when it cites prior sources at many times. For example, the Book of Jasher, the Book of the Wars of Yahweh, and the Book of Iddo the Seer. This is not necessarily a modern idea either of Wellhausen's, considering the fact that similar analysis was concluded by scholars such as Baruch Spinoza, Thomas Hobbes, and John Estruch in the 1600s. In J text, Yahweh is the most anthropomorphic, forming man from clay with his hands, enjoying walks in the cool of evening, stitching clothes for Adam and Eve from animal pelts, enjoying the food Abram cooks for him, speaking face to face with humans, being bargained with, and so forth. J is particularly interested in the traditions of Judah, and it supports Judah against Israel, for example, suggesting that Israel acquired its capital at Shechem by massacring the inhabitants. And J supports the priests who descend from Aaron, who were established in Jerusalem, the capital of Judah. While Wellhausen placed the date for J text at around 950 BC, a crucial study by H. H. Schmid demonstrated that J was conscious of the prophetic works of the 7th century BC, while the prophets did not know of the traditions of the Torah, meaning that J cannot be earlier than the 7th century BC. Many current theories place J even later, such as that of Russell E. Gmirkin. E-text is characterized by its virtually exclusive use of the plural term Elohim for the deity, along with its use of the phrase fear of God. It holds a rather abstract view of the deity, and strangely uses Horeb instead of Sinai for the mountain where Moses received the laws. E-text, favoring Israel, represents traditions from the northern kingdom of Israel, and exhibits a fascination with its heroes, such as Joseph and Joshua, speaking negatively of Aaron, for example, claiming that he led the Israelites to worship the golden calf. Before the redactor edited it, E-text told the story of Abraham and Isaac, in which Abraham is not stopped, and Isaac never appears again, suggesting rather that Isaac was sacrificed. And the early tradition, recorded in the Midrash, still preserves the version of the tale in which Isaac was killed. While the J-text depicts the anthropomorphic God that is involved with humans on earth, the Elohist source frequently involves angels, for example, telling of a ladder of angels that leads up to El, whereas in J, this is simply a dream in which God is above the location. E-text also goes to excessive lengths to depict the Egyptians negatively, and it depicts Moses as threatening Pharaoh and bringing the plagues himself. The priestly source, P-text, is unique among the other sources, and is characterized by significant contradictions with them. In P-text, Aaron and the priesthood have an exalted status, and there is no sacrifice ordained by God at Sinai. Ritual laws and origins of shrines are stressed, as is the role of priests. Unique to P is the assertion that only descendants of Aaron were allowed to officiate in the inner sanctum. P's God is majestic and transcendent, and according to P, all things occur because of his power. Also unique to P is that the deity reveals himself in stages, first as Elohim, then as El Shaddai to Abram, and then as Yahweh, only to Moses and those following him. In Exodus 6:3, Yahweh reveals his name to Moses, saying that no one had yet known this name, and Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob only knew him as El Shaddai. But according to J text, in Genesis 15, Abraham clearly knows the name of Yahweh, and Yahweh himself says, "I am Yahweh." P is significantly concerned with holiness, meaning ritual purity, and Israel is posited as a priestly kingdom and holy nation, with elaborate rules that are aimed at preserving this purity. Most scholars agree that P-Source was written either during or after the exilic period around 530 BC. The Deuteronomist source, although found mostly in Deuteronomy through 2 Kings, underlies much of the Hebrew Bible. The Deuteronomistic history originated independently of the books Genesis, Exodus, Numbers, and the history found in the Book of the Chronicles. Scholars trace all or most of it to the 6th century BC. It tells of a story in which a book of the law was supposedly found during the reign of King Josiah, and which caused the king to embark on a series of religious changes. And it has been suggested that this source was manufactured in order to validate his program of religious change. Deuteronomist theology is conceived in the form of the suzerainty or covenant between Israel and Yahweh, who elected them and requires them to live according to his law. Under this treaty, Yahweh has granted a conditional promise to the Israelites of the land of Canaan. The interpretation asserted in D-text explains Israel's successes as the result of obedience and its failures as the result of disobedience. Contrary to the other three texts, in which independent shrines or priesthoods are represented as legitimate, D-text insists on a centralized worship around the temple in Jerusalem. Lastly, D-text asserts all Israelites as brothers and sisters, and each will answer to God for his treatment of his neighbor. These four texts were combined at two points in time by editors or redactors, who appear to have kept as much as possible from the source documents, firstly by combining J and E to form JE. The redactor of JE is thought to have added very little, only a few phrases in the attempt to remove serious contradictions and maintain the flow of the story between the texts. The main exception to this is in the story of Abraham sacrificing Isaac, where the redactor added an angel stopping Abraham and replacing the boy with a ram. During the Babylonian exile, J-E was unified with P and E by a different redactor, which many theorize to be Ezra during the time of Cyrus the Great. And that, as we have it, is the combined sources of the Hebrew Bible.